So just a few words to this public program. In 2019, the Joint Ventures event series explores questions of good life and coexistence. What does community solidarity look like? How will we remain empowered to act even in troubled times? What about the common good and what are commons? A forum will be created with this public program in which artists and cultural workers, museum visitors and flaneurs, people interested and people committed, amateurs and professionals can exchange ideas and network. As I said, the second program in the series Joint Ventures focuses on queer topics in museums, and each time at this public program, a local community project will be introduced or a local building group will present their project. And in keeping with this, a specific format in which to experience the content and community is created. And I'm very happy that Queerbau accepted my invitation to present their exciting and successful housing projects, but they will tell about the success themselves. I would like to introduce the people here with me on the stage. You have here, maybe you can wave when I say your name. There is Andreas Konechny. He is the initiator, founder, and organizer of Queerbau Wien, Queerbau Vienna, and he's also living at Queerbau. Then there is Roland Hampel. He is here. Roland is an architect and also also one of the initiators of Queerbau. Then there is Hilde Grammel. She is a feminist activist. She was involved in many feminist projects, magazines, also as a writer and translator. And she is responsible for the community program at the Queerbau. It's called the Nachbarinnen-Treff Jella Jella. Then there is Georg Blaschke. He's a choreographer and performer, and he also lives at Queerbau. Then Anja Filatova, we will greet her. She will greet us with a video message. She's an artist. She comes from Kiev, but is living in Vienna. And she's also involved with Queerbau at the Wildgarten. And then there is Cornelia Kunert. She's a psychotherapist, also artist, and a trans activist. And she will be a future resident at Queerbau Wildgarten. So welcome, thank you for being here, and please give us your presentation.
Thank you, Christiane. Thank you for inviting us and that we have the possibility to speak about our projects. It's a great honor to be here in the Belvedere 21 with a new name. For most of the people, we know it as the 20er Haus, 21er Haus, and now it's Belvedere 21. Together with Roland Hampel, we are the initiators of the Queerbau project. Together with my friends and neighbors, whose name you will find on the next slide, we will give you a glance of our journey through co-housing between individuality and community. So we were already introduced, so I can jump over this, I think, and let's start. What is it what we wanted to realize with the Queerbau project? First of all, we wanted to create a neighborhood with people who normally are not invited to build their own townhouse. New families, foster families, trans people, refugees, lesbian and gay people. Normally, you have to be more wealthy to be able to afford engaging an architect to create your private home. So we had the idea to create a new urban townhouse together with the future residents. New urban means to take part. It's about empowerment and self-esteem. The initiative comes not from the top, but from the bottom. And at the bottom are a lot of diverse people who were waiting to take part in urban development. We especially invited people who work with fluid transgender identities and or with diversity in sexual orientation or simply wished to live in an open-minded community to play an active role in the project and future neighborhood. And at the same time, it is about going beyond fixed categories and attribution on an experimental basis. The main exercise is tolerance within the community and the entire neighborhood, and to have an effect on the city, it's about democracy. Here you can see how we did it. Picture postcards showing different images of future community life and our motto, everyone for her and himself and some things together. Speaking about respecting individuality and combining it with community. Everyone gets his own flat and there are community facilities too. Another postcard proclaims Querdenken, thinking outside the box. Or ich bin ich, I am me, asking for tolerance. And a very important postcard, the second here on the screen, says ich bin da, I am here, referring to the simple fact that lesbian and gay couples are caring for children. And these children feel comfortable in a wider neighborhood of understanding and security. At kindergarten or school, they sometimes need the power to explain that they live with two mothers or fathers. A secure home with a lot of understanding people around may provide the strength needed someday. The linguistic gap, now maybe you can jump one slide, sorry, I was too slow. The linguistic gap in the main slogan, here you can see it, it's used to symbolize the space for including all. So that's the reason for this gap. Now the next. Of course you need partners to build a house. We are working with cooperative building societies. They are specialized in developing residential buildings and they do it under the rules of affordable housing in Vienna, which is the most important aspect when we're speaking about building new urban homes. Our cooperative building partners are WBV GPA and EBG. They must be mentioned because without their openness and understanding, it would not have been possible to realize such projects. The participatory planning process, look how it was set up. First, everyone received a questionnaire to answer personal questions like how you want to live, what are you planning to do more often in your flat, and the architect presented in the second phase the first ideas of the flat, and then all apartments were put together in one plan. After the discussion of the blueprint, the people were invited to think and plan the community facilities together. After the house was built according to the need and of the future residents and the architect plan, some people were engaging in constructing the community room as a cafe, so the Yella Yella was created, and you can see some pictures that the people were really engaged in doing all the things placed in the Yella Yella. So we build a bar at the tables, a big bank, sofa, it's called. The community is not isolated. It is not a lesbian gay ghetto. It is open like a city itself is supposed to be. We are also thinking about who needs a home the most and who we must not forget. We concluded that there are queer people who are fleeing their countries and that we have to reserve space for them too. For everybody, housing is a question of access and affordability. We organized to grant the access to the project and the city provides the program for affordable housing. The other aspect of being open refers to the quarter and what is planned there. It is about going there before the house was built and look what's going on in the whole development area. There are a lot of plans made from different sides, the developers, the district, the city, but the future residents must be included in the plans too. In Seestadt, we were engaged in planning of a park, in setting up a speed limit for the main street in front of the house, in urban gardening. We have worked repeatedly with students learning how different planning processes may form an open city. So here you can see some of the spaces included. There are community spaces included, and there are commercial spaces. First of all, I go back to the affordable housing topic. You see that there are two different funds for private flats. There is affordable housing for 60 euros per square meter and the subsidized housing 500, and there is a big difference. Both are seen as affordable. And the rent is approximately 7 euros per square meter. The community spaces you can see is, of course, the lobby, there is a workshop, a tea house, you have a yoga and a seminar room in Seestadt, and a roof terrace, there is urban gardening. And the commercial spaces is the Jella Jella, which means that the residents have to pay rent for it, and there is a co-working space, a food cop, and a sports room. I think I have overjumped some slides, no? Or did I? No? Maybe?
Yeah.
Okay. So, next speaking is Hilde. She will tell us about the Jella Jella. She makes the program there, and continue.
Well, hello everybody, also from my part. I'm very glad to be here and to be able to talk about what I've been involved in the past year. I'm more or less coordinating the programs, not so much organizing it. Okay, what was the idea behind the Jella Jella? Andreas mentioned one aspect already. Another is that we did not want the premises on the ground floor of our house to be an ordinary shop or an unused community space, which is quite typical of many houses, but we wanted it to be a lively and vibrant meeting place for ourselves with the neighborhood. So that is the main idea behind the Jella Jella, a space covering 120 square meters. Currently, we are open on Thursday evening and every other Sunday. On Thursday, the residents of one floor of our house cook and work at the bar that is open from 6 to 11 p.m. and sometimes later. And every other Sunday, we are open for brunch from 10 a.m. to 2 p.m. Until recently, there was one additional evening for lovers of board games, which did not only attract people living in the house, but also from the neighborhood outside. First, let me give you an idea of what happens at the Jella Jella, which is like the park opposite our house, named for Jella Herzka, an activist of the Women's International League for Peace and Freedom, before she had to leave Austria in 1939. And the name also echoes the Arabic or Hebrew Yala Yala, which might be translated into Viennese as hurry up, don't waste any time. We started the Yala Yala with an opening party on the 21st of October 2017. And now, until now, we have been contributing as a house cultural events to the just emerging Seestadt scene by organizing a very diverse program consisting, among others, of exhibitions, readings, concerts, radio programs, theme parties, and a recent climate party. As you will notice, not all our programs are queer in the narrow sense of the word, but provide opportunities for the neighborhood to come together and experience that queer people are people engaged in lots of different things. And after all, we live in the same world as everybody else. The events are based on the initiative and interests of the individuals who live in our house. So this brings me to the exhibitions. We started the series with a Jella Herzka exhibition opened on the 12th of March 2018 on the occasion of the 80th anniversary of the Anschluss and of Hitler's troops landing on the Aspern airfield nearby. The exhibition documented Herzka's international network of women peace activists, her years in exile in Britain, by the way, and her return to Austria, where she had to fight for the restitution of her property. This exhibition, first one, was followed by a Madame Dora exhibition. As some of you might well know, Madame Dora, also called Dora Kalmus, was a well-renowned photographer of the Austrian and international high society and the world of artists and fashion. She suffered a break of her career when she was persecuted by the Nazis, a break also reflected in her photos. The exhibition was the result of a cooperation with Theatre 7 and their so-called Station Theatre, which toured Seestadt, bringing to public awareness the lives of the women who the streets are named for. Maybe you might know, maybe you don't, but the streets in Seestadt are named for women, historical, not present, but historical. After that, we showed paintings by Leopold Kellermann, Sylvia Penter, and Waltraud Pollack, all of them late residents of the neighborhood. The pictures were provided by Wolfgang Pollack. He's also here today. Thank you for coming. A man who lives in the Aspern Hausfeld settlement next to Seestadt. So you can see it has been important for us also to connect to people who already lived in the neighborhood. And what is being prepared right now is a more queer exhibition, one of comics for children at the windows of the Yella Yella facing the streets, comics that explain in a funny way the terms LGBTQI or what it means to be queer. A cooperation with the Urban District Management of Seestadt, where the exhibitions of Ada Lovelace, a computer pioneer, and Maria Tusch, one of the first 9 female representatives in the Austrian Parliament of 1919, with both of them having streets named for them. Maria Tusch was a social democrat and trade unionist who fought for the legislation of abortion as early as the 1920s. This leads me to the next point, concerts. We invited local musicians as well as people from the city because, as you might know, Seestadt is not in the city but quite in the suburbs. We invited musicians to play live evening concerts or to provide a relaxed atmosphere during the Sunday brunches. And also a queer choir from Berlin entertained the audience with their medley ranging from political songs to parodies of songs from the 1970s. Another highlight a few months ago was a literary reading with Marlene Strerowitz, one of Austria's most prominent feminist writers. She talked to us about what it meant to live as a woman in the past 50 years and how politics have in that period of time either facilitated or prevented a self-determined life for women. The discussion also included the question how to act in the face of the conservative right-wing extremist government we had at that time and might get again. Hopefully not. Another track is the Yella Yella Talk. Once a month, a radio reporter from Seestadt meets up with a bunch of people, one or two inhabitants of our house among them, interviewing them about their lives in the neighborhood or involving them into talks about topics such as culture, quality of life, etc. Needless to say, we also take the occasions of seasonal calendar of the seasonal calendar offers to invite the neighborhood for parties and other come-togethers. Halloween, New Year's Eve, the Persian Nowruz, a giveaway market before Christmas are typical formats. These provide an opportunity for people to come together and enjoy relaxed evenings in our queer community. And this brings me to my last part. The Yella Yella can also be rented. In the course of the year, it was a location for different groups and initiatives to hold their meetings. Among others of Edible Seestadt, Save the Lobau Natural Reserve, of the local food co-op who showed the movie Our Farmer and who offered samples of their products. Another group that was active for a while organized the so-called Beat Salon, an evening with DJ and dancing once a month. And just recently, a new resident of the Seestadt Urban Development Area approached us with the idea of public film screenings once a month. Films he will choose, but which we also can decide. So, this concludes my presentation, which I hope could give you an impression of what goes on at the Yella Yella, a queer community space for the neighborhood, and for ourselves, of course. If you have any questions, please feel free to ask me afterwards.
So, before we come to the next speaker, it's Anja from Kiev who will join us in the Queerbau project in Wildgarten. I must explain that we have two projects. One is in Queerbau Seestadt, which is in the 22nd district of Vienna, in the east of Vienna. And the second one is called Wildgarten in the 12th district near Rosenhügel. So, we have the two projects. This is what I forgot to tell you. Anja will move into the Wildgarten project. The Wildgarten project is not yet completed, but the construction will start by the end of the year. So she is from Kiev. It's another aspect of being open. It's not only about refugees, but it's also about being open to artists from other countries of Europe, for example. And she will tell us her story and her relation to Vienna now.
Hello, I'm Anya Filatova, Greece from Kiev, where I prepare my documents for permission to stay, which I do every year. It's a wonderful European tradition, which I respect as a foreigner and newcomer. I first came to Vienna in 2011 for Kunst und Kapital exhibition in Künstlerhaus. In artist tandem with Michael Blim, we made a work which is called Iron Curtain. It's about an experiment of coexistence, of possible coexistence of Eastern and Western and Central Europe. In Vienna, I recognize many symptoms that bother me in Kiev. For example, these phallic towers that mark every district. They remind me a lot on Kiev architecture in times of turbo capitalism, when one who has the biggest wallet puts the biggest stick in the juiciest place. In the landscape you have on the display, I just overpainted it. In following years, I spent more time in Vienna and realized that time takes time in the city, and I realized a project called Time in Vienna, Lviv, Kiev, and Saki, Crimea. And it seemed that pace of time in Vienna is slower, but pressure is higher. In Vienna, there is a term called Durchwurstern, which means to get along somehow, but it's not considered to be a norm. There are real norms, what is to be a good bürger, a good citizen, including numbers in the bank account and the number of square meters you own or occupy. And if you want to get a visa, you have to also fulfill the requirements. Vienna was the easiest choice for us, but I also was considering going back to Ukraine. Socializing there would be more complicated, but more for my ex-partner, of course. And it was strange to see that even in alternative community, people were sure that if I got the permission to stay in the European Union, I would never even think of going to Ukraine again. Being homesick and overwhelmed by questions about war with Russia, I painted this landscape of a district on the border. It's a river on the border between Russia and Ukraine. These are stills from my performance bags in Spektakel Theater. In one summer, I lived in Gemeindebau, in Altbau, in WG, in Wagenburg, in Alte Donau, in a container on the Danube Channel. So I experienced a lot of different kinds of co-living, coexistence in Vienna. And then from Artistic Network, I heard about Wildgarten, Queerbett, and I came to the open doors, and I was accepted to the community, which I'm very happy for. Since in Vienna, time takes time, the house will be ready in several years before our community can move in. But in the meantime, I learned an important game, which is called Mensch, ärger dich nicht, which means don't get angry, man. Also in the meantime, our family became patchwork family and multinational, to which I dedicated the latest works. And I have to say that this change in my status was more accepted in Austria than in Ukraine. And about this, I made a performance called Taum Ate. Last summer, I made inquiry among my friends, female friends mainly, about offending, discouraging comments from their close circle. And most of the comments were about get job, get kids, get normal. Since then, I deal with the topic what is normal, how normal it is to be not normal. But I definitely stay not normal, queer in a wide sense, and I stay sincerely yours, Ania Filatov from Kiev. Thanks and ciao.
So we cannot say thank you because you will not hear us, but we are very grateful. Next speaking is Cornelia Kunert. She's a psychologist and painter, and she will speak for herself.
Yeah, my English is not so fluent as Anja's, so I apologize. But I was asked to share some thoughts about living queer living. So and I will share some thoughts about categories and limits. You know the acronym LGBT, I think you know it. Do you know the acronym LGBTIQ plus? Or better, do you know the acronym LGBTTIQ plus? Or do you know the acronym ABCDEFGHII2Z plus? So you could add any letter you want, and if you match, okay, fine. So do we really need this LGBT plus stuff? I always try to look around at the physics and biology if I have some questions. And the biologist Robert Sapolsky from Stanford University said, "We break things into categories. We do this in various settings because it could be extremely useful. It's a biological feature." So for example, take a rainbow. It's red to violet, it's violet to red. Various wavelengths in the electromagnetic field in a continuum. We divide it in red, orange, yellow, green, blue, indigo, and violet. A continuum that we break into boundaries, into categories. We set limits and transform the continuum into different entities. How comes? There's a biological reason why we do that. It's evolutionary segregated. We do that because it makes easier to store information and deal with different facts. Using categories makes it easier for us to remember things and evaluate them. It's to put it, it's a way to navigate in the world. It's a tool for decision making. So remember, it's a habit, not a truth. The truth is the continuum. Milton Diamond, a famous researcher for transgender biology, said, "Nature loves variety. Unfortunately, society hates it." So these are some works done by me. So categories are useful, but they also bring some difficulties with them. One of the difficulties is you underestimate how different the facts are that fall into the same category. For example, depression, blue mood, and suicidal attempts. So very big difference in the same category. On the other end, you overestimate how different they are when it happens to be a limit between them. For example, animals and humans, or immigrants and inhabitants, or men and women, or strangers and housemates. I had an experience once when I had an exhibition at the Essel Museum at Klosterneuburg, and the curator introduced me to a collector, a Viennese collector. And if he saw me and I spoke to him, and he said, "Oh, I prefer to speak a real woman." So this is not life-threatening, sure, but it's insulting, and it hurts somehow. It's not nice. Conclusion. What's the conclusion? When you pay attention to the limits and categories, you don't see the big picture. We are all humans. The World Wide Web is not only internet. Even as it's part of the evolution behavior, we should try not to fall into categories. We always share something with the other, even if we seem very different. When you agree to that, you're welcome at the plus, at the LGBT plus. So Vienna is a beautiful city where you can live well as a queer person, and that is very good. We are proud to live here and to realize this housing project with support of the city. And as Andres said, we don't plan any ghetto. We want just to live in peace and respect at a place where it is not necessary to hold the lover's hand, hide us, and secretly, and where no one judges us if we appear female, male, or in between. We want positive regard from neighbors in despite of our sexual orientation or identity. And now the last word about queerness. To have a certain sexual orientation or a certain gender identity is not a matter of free choice or free will or a playful thing somehow. You are born with it, and it's more or less constitutional. But to be queer is a decision to make, to stand for that. It means to prefer to be proud than to live in a shadow. If you look around globally, you will find that in every society that tends to be totalitarian, the homosexuals and transsexuals always live in danger, threatened by their life and their rights. In this way, we take care for one another, and as well as for the existence of an open society. That's why, for us, the most private is the most political.
Thank you very much, Cornelia. Next, speaking, but not only speaking, but showing a video, is Georg Blaschke. He's a choreographer and performer.
Thank you. Well, hi everybody. I am choreographer, freelance, and freelance producer in Vienna. And since the beginning of Queerbau, based there with my family, Juna and Claire. Last year, I was asked by a neighborhood festival to organize a kind of community dance project with the goal to include the residents of our house. This festival was called My Seestadt, and it was taking place for the first time in the surroundings of the of Seestadt, aiming to initiate lots of activities and workshops and rehearsals with musicians, dancers, and with the focus on community dance and mixed ability dance. So over a stretch of approximately 2 months, there have been taking place a lot of activities with the body in the Seestadt, and accumulating later in an outdoor performance day, end of June 2018. So I was asked to do one of these projects, and as I was not sure about the dancing mood and the dancing fever of all of the residents of our house, I had the idea to approach my neighbors actually with a verbal intervention first. So what I did was I went from door to door knocking, like over the period of 1 month, and those who let me in, I was asking always the same three questions about their life in the Queerbau, about how they feel in the Seestadt, in the neighborhood, and what they would dream about, how their future would be in this environment. And I was asking them only to answer with the body or with a gesture and a short movement, which was not so easy for many of the people. But actually, I recorded only the non-verbal sections, meaning the movements, with the camera of my mobile phone, so very simple, handmade video I did. And I was collecting these statements, like 30 statements approximately, and these materials later were the base for a kind of choreography that I created with volunteers from the house that wanted to dance, then really to make a dance out of these gestures. And so the next step was rehearsing, and we created a very nice choreography together with a professional music band. And on this very day of outdoor performances, we presented this dance on our platform, as we have a platform in the backside of our house in the community garden beside the sandbox. And so we performed there with this music band in the frame of the other outdoor performances. I called this work Shake the House. And what I did the last month, following this invitation today, I was rewatching the materials, which was a really true pleasure for me, also touching, because 1 year passed and many things again happened in the house and around Seestadt, also from the architecture side. And I made a clip, a trailer, with these images that in a way summarizes and includes the process of this project. And I want to show you this trailer now.
Illusion, just a happiness dream. Illusion is just your happiness. Illusion. his color, with his blood. I'd say you shouldn't be alive. Getting away from it all, like a shooting star, is just your illusion.
Thank you very much, Georg. It's unbelievable and touching, but this is what artists do with people. So,
thank you, Quirbau, for this really great presentation. I think people.
One sentence more. We just want to remind our Yella Yella is the open door to the city, which means you can visit us on Thursdays and every second Sunday for brunch. The next big thing, important thing, will be on Sunday the 16th of June. It's a charity brunch for our refugee housing project, and Gorgi is here. He will have some more information about that if you're interested. Thank you for your interest, and now we are done.
Thank you. I would like to immediately actually invite the audience if there are comments or questions, because this is, as long as we have you here, they can address you directly. Are there some comments or questions, please?
Thank you very much for your presentation. I have a question regarding to the inspiration behind the Quirbau. Is there any project that existed before somewhere in Austria or in Europe that inspired you to set up this kind of building architecturally and as a community-based place? But in my case, I am familiar with many money-driven places, for example, in the United States, which are like senior communities. For senior queer people, but you have to have a lot of money, of course, to join this kind of exclusively queer, safe communities and be a senior citizen there. this is my own, the only thing that comes up to my mind, but maybe you you know other projects that are not only kind of artistic, quirky, temporary project, but a more temporary social architectural project that you are inspired by, setting up this very kind of intriguing and inspirational place.
Okay, so actually it's not a luxury housing program. It's in Vienna, it's under the program of affordable housing. It has two categories of flats. And what we have done as a Queerbau association, we tried also to integrate and give access to people who normally don't even have the access to the cheapest flats in Vienna. For example, when it comes to the refugees or other disadvantaged people. The question if we have something to look at and make somehow a copy. Yes, in Vienna there was the Rosa Lilla Villa, for example, which consists of a cafe, of a, some flats there to rent. And what we wanted is to make it more coming up to the times now, to update it somehow, this idea of queer housing projects. And this was coming out. So the next thing is that the queer community was changing in their needs, for example, yeah? And that more and more people got children to care of. And this is why we wanted to create an urban house, just a normal urban house. And that was the result.
Thank you. More questions from your side? I would like to know how can one live there, get an apartment? Or you also mentioned that Queerbau, that your second project, Queerbau im Wildgarten, this is to be developed yet, it is not finished. How do you find the tenants?
Yeah, the access...
When can we come for the casting?
Yeah, that's a good question about the casting, because there is no casting. Yeah, there is no casting. We give just the information via internet. You can go to the website www.queerbau.at, and there you find information where is the next meeting for the community or of the community, and then that's the way how you join. Yeah, we did no casting, so there are other co-housing groups in Vienna which are not queer, but they have their own themes, and sometimes they do castings because they want to have people who have more in common with each other. And this is a little bit different to our co-housing project. Yeah? We have something in common. It is to be more tolerant, or to wish to be more tolerant to the others. We have a queer background, or we have friends who are queer. But we don't have in common that we are all for ecology, or that we are all, I don't know, this on the, of the same age, for example. So it's a very diverse and a complex community, how, so to say. Yeah. Yeah. So.
But in preparation to the project, we come together frequently to build work groups and encounter and so on to find decisions for the project, for the future, and also to encounter ourselves. And I think this is important, that so that you don't think that we don't know each other and everyone comes. You have to attend somehow to the project.
Please. That actually sparks a question in my mind. One of the issues that we have in London is that a lot of queer spaces are now no longer queer. that, and this seems to be a trend that is wider than this. Thinking about the longer future of this community, have you thought about how you will preserve its special spirit, which comes across very strongly in all of your presentations?
So you mean when new people move in, how they adapt to the idea, and we hope that the queer thing is a very funny thing, because we have the second E of the word queer we put in bracelets, to symbolize that it is something which is wider than that, because it comes to the German word quer, yeah, and querdenken, thinking outside the box, is not only related to being LGBT something. So if we are living in a liberal open city, and if we will be living in a liberal open city in the future, we have the idea, so in the city, and it's alive. Yeah, it will change the project over the time. So you cannot preserve it, I think.
Yeah, I think it all depends on the people who live in this house. If they are interested in a number of topics and active in movements, etc., I think this can keep up and keep alive the spirit of such a house. And another thing is, of course, that nothing is prevented. Everything is allowed. Yeah. And we try to keep up the connections and the links we have to the outside neighborhood in all possible ways. Hopefully it will work long.
I know you're working on some other projects and expanding to the other location. Would you ever consider making spaces in the queer living for students specifically? Because I know, because it's sometimes hard for students to find, like, personally, I know that, like, when I realized I was going to be a student in Vienna, I realized I would have to pay more for single housing because I would not feel safe with a roommate who I did not know previously, and I could not find a dorm that was affordable, that was also safe for queer people. So that's why I'm just wondering if student housing is something you would ever consider adding as maybe a part of a future neighborhood.
Yeah, actually in the Wildgarten project we have some apartments which are student size-like, so it's only 30 square meters. But what is more important about that is the exercise that we do. By naming it queer, just naming the project queers, we send a message to the city. Yeah, and this message to the city means, think about it, that queer is also a housing problem, so to say. Yeah, it is about living in the city, organizing it, have a place to be. Yeah, and it is an experiment that we do. It is a process that we do, and it is an exercise that we do. So that is what I can say to the students' home. If it is a good idea to do only a queer students' home, I don't know. We must think about it. Yeah. Normally, I think it's always good to have a very mixed neighborhood.
Thank you. I would like to make a suggestion. I think you will all be here around also later, and you will be available. One can address you directly. But I would also like to show you this handout, the information sheet we put in front of the room on a chair. There is a lot of information about Queerbau, also the website and the contact information. So please take one of these handouts, and if there are no one left, then let me know, because I have plenty here in the front. So thank you very much, Roland, Cornelia, Andreas, Hilde, and Georg for this presentation. Thank you.
Thank you.